Pillar to Post, ensuring confident homeownership. Call today to book your home inspection.
I'm Hunter Wade at the Athletes Lounge podcast, and I'm here with my guest.
Hi, I'm Sue Kunkle. I'm the head softball coach at the University of Southern Indiana.
So, Coach, just going right into it, where are you in your season right now?
We are, this upcoming weekend is our third conference weekend. So, I mean, we're knee deep in it already.
So, what do you think about, I guess, your team's, performance so far? What do you think about, what's been your review up to this point in the season?
Preseason, we had some tough competition and we played well. We made some mistakes and we're still learning, a little bit young in different areas, but we're kind of starting to put things together. We're starting to click a little bit better as a team. The OVC is kind of our main goal, and those preseason games are basically, getting us ready to play some of the best teams in the conference. So, we're starting to figure things out. Pitching has been solid and now we're starting to have less errors and work some better at the offense side.
I always ask this of all college coaches and they all kind of give a similar answer. How much you have the stuff before the pre-conference schedule is, kind of a warm up for the conference schedule, because the conference schedules kind of dictates, where your postseason goes and all that. So was there anything you tried to, what's the thing you try to work on most prior to the conference schedule?
I think it's more about just trying to play as a team a little better. That preseason time is used a lot for, moving kids around and kind of seeing where things are gonna play out. When you get to conference play, it's a little bit more important that you have some more consistency and stability in a lineup. So, that part of it was nice to see a lot of people move in different positions and whatnot, but, we're trying to really work on our communication on the field right now, because with so many different new faces and whatnot, it's been an obstacle for us, just making sure that we're kind of like all on the same page after, before and during every pitch.
At this point in the year, are you kind of like, you're still developing, but is this kind of around where you want the team to be, humming at? Is this around where you want them?
No, we want to peak near the last stretch of conference. So we are definitely not peaking yet, and that's not a bad thing. So we welcome mistakes. We just hope that there's like growth from game to game and making sure that people are like learning from their mistakes and whatnot, because, if you're not being able to like fix things and grow, then we're not going to get any better.
Have you had any games so far this year that kind of had you on the edge of your seat? I know you've seen quite a bit over your.
All of them. We were ahead 6-0. We had that kind of game, and then, we made some changes and tried to mix some things up, and it's 6-6 going in the seventh. That was a little scary. We played Alabama this year and kept them 2-0. It was a great game. There's just been a lot of excitement. There's been some games that have been, tough losses, going, being tied, or, going into the 6th, 7th inning and losing it. But it's, in my opinion, those just make you stronger. I mean, you you're going to have to suffer some failure and some losses along the way that sting a little bit to have any chance of being successful.
This thing I want to mention here, you were kind of in a unique position because you oversaw the transition, of the jump from D2 to D1. And how do you, view that, how do you think you handled the transition, and have you been pleasantly surprised of how the program's been able to keep up?
I've been here a long time. So, it's kind of one of those things where, I loved who we were. I loved who we were as a a culture, a program, and you know, we were very successful. And so that was tough. It was hard for me to wrap my head around it for a minute. You know, but you know, as we went, we had no doubt that we would compete. We would, you know, we would hang with just about any mid-major Division I school. It was more about just if how we were going to present it, like recruiting wise. We were worried about that because, you know, that 22 class that came in, they basically came in here thinking that they were going to have a shot at a national championship. And obviously that's not the case. You know, we have to do the transition and we are not able to qualify for postseason. So that's been kind of the biggest obstacle, I guess, you know, but I mean, we're shooting for a conference championship and that's great. And it's going to be wonderful the minute that we do it. But you know, I wasn't surprised that we had a really great first year. You know, and, you know, and obviously this year is kind of having its moments, but we still have a long way to go. And, but you know, yeah, the D2 thing, it was, you know, it was a great, great ride and, you know, so many wonderful memories. And we just kind of tell them that we're making new ones, you know, different ones. And, the team seems to be handling it well as well.
You know, has recruiting philosophy changed at all because of the jump, or did you kind of keep it the same?
Yeah, we don't necessarily recruit differently. It's more about, we have to do it more, a little more. You know, some of our, you know, like last fall we had 15, 16, you know, visits, kids just back to back, and days were jammed packed with, you know, people that just want to play here. And I think that's, you know, a testament to our university, but it's also a testament to our program and, you know, what we stand for. So I think it's, you know, but when it comes to the type of kid, you know, we still look for the athlete, the overall athlete, the one that's very versatile and the one that has some decent size and power and strength, but we've kind of been recruiting that kid all along. So it hasn't been terribly different for sure.
So I'm just looking at, you know, like your schedule from earlier this year. Mm-hmm. What is it, you know, are the 10 a.m., 9 a.m. start times, you know, is there a different mentality that goes into those from, you know, could what your normal start times one or three?
No, you know, I mean, our spring break, you know, we were welcoming of the 9-10 a.m. games because, you know, gave us the rest of the day to do team stuff and enjoy the good weather and whatnot. But normally we don't play that early unless it's a tournament with like several teams in or Florida, like our spring break trip. But yeah, it's been the 9-10 o'clock we're welcoming of it. It's not that difficult.
Only when the weather's nice, it holds. It all works.
Pillar to Post Home Inspectors, the Jeff Wade team, ensuring confident home ownership. Call 812-490-2127 to schedule your home inspection.
Going into the conference schedule, you know, I guess the rest of the conference schedule, you know, are there any, not every conference game's important, are there any games you're looking forward to, you know, just for like a, I guess measuring stick games, or any games you just, or any places you just like to go to play at?
Well, you know, I mean, obviously we're, you know, some of these schools, you know, because we were home against some of these teams last year and now we're going away. So a lot of them are new, you know. Obviously we go to Lindenwood and we've already been there because they were in the GLVC with us at D2. But you know, there's some of them that we haven't been to, so it'll be interesting. But you know, there's not any easy teams. There's no easy weekends to like get fired up for, in a sense of like, oh, we're going to go in there and sweep. But you know, there's a couple that are going to be tough. They're going to be tough weekends. Like we have SEMO and EIU, two of the top teams in the conference. We have them at home this year, so that is fabulous. EIU is also a alumni weekend for us and everything, so we'll have a really nice crowd, and so I'm sure our team will be excited to be at home and play them.
What percentage of your girls come from I guess the local area or within like 2 or 3 hours, do you think?
Most of them, truthfully, we have a lot of our kids live like in up by the Indianapolis area, just within like 3 4 hour drive. We do get a couple Illinois kids, like Chicago area, several Kentucky kids, like Louisville and that kind of area. But most of our kids are kind of, like this kind of local Midwest. So it's nice. We have several local kids now too. So the talent around here is getting a little better.
Does that make the Butler trip a little bit more exciting?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. We don't ever shy away from like having a chance to go up there in that area to play. It's just a closer drive for all those parents.
So right now, you mentioned that your pitching's held up pretty well this year, and I think that's shown in most box scores. You guys have kept runs, pretty low, scored against you. I mean, you mentioned that 0-2 or the 0-2 game against Bama. They're a big school, keeping them to 2 runs they probably weren't expecting. The so what is the you know what goes into that? Is that like your big area of focus as a coach? Is pitching your biggest area, or is that just kind of happened to be the thing that's been clicking so far?
Yeah, I mean, I think, well, I mean, I was a pitcher, so yeah,
Yeah.
I'm a little partial to the pitchers, but we've always just had a really solid pitching staff. We've been a little down on the fall, this fall side, like this fall season, because we had some nagging injuries. So, they missed that time to grow, but they're starting to really put things together now. We have four kids. We have three of them that throw a lot. The other one plays mainly second base. But it's just been a really good position for us for years. Yeah, I mean, I think it's just more about the experience. The more innings they get and being able to like go back at it on a Monday or Tuesday after a weekend and kind of fine-tune some of the things that they didn't do well. And yeah, I mean, I just tell them, you keep us in a game and we'll do our best to figure the rest of it out. Offense is starting to people are just getting a little bit more confident at the plate. So we're starting to make really good contact. And we need to clean up our defense a little bit, and it's a little bit that's kind of new for me as well. We've always been real solid defensively as well, but it's a little bit of a quicker game. It's not much different from D2 to D1 from what we've seen. But the pitchers, they're a little bit more spinny. The strike zone is a little tighter. But other than that, I think we're on the track for some really good stuff.
What does the average, I guess, non-game day look like for you guys at this point in the season?
Well, like a Tuesday, Thursday, they train with our strength coach from, 7 to 8:45 in the morning. They go to class, and then we come back for practice about 3 o'clock on a Wednesday and a Friday. We normally go from like 2:30 to 4:30 outside, and hopefully, I mean, obviously when the weather's bad, we're inside hitting, but Monday's normally our day off.
The can so what you're saying is everyone looks forward towards the Mondays.
Monday is day to recover. That's for treatment, ice baths.
We talked about a lot of these new, I guess, places you're going to this year, new facilities. You guys haven't been there before. So is there anything that you have to do differently when you're not really sure how the place is laid out or anything, or is it pretty simple?
No, see, that is one thing that's a little different with the D1 thing. We have like timing sheets now, so we have to follow like a certain protocol. At this time it's bat testing, and this time we get the cages, and then the other team gets the cages, and defensive lines pregame, and then it's this how many minutes you're at the plate for exchanging lineups. It's just, it's very regimented, so you really just follow it. You just try to follow it to a T, and it all works out. So
So, how much prep work goes into like each, I guess, series that you have of a team? Like obviously, Lyndon Woods coming up in a in this weekend. So how much prep work goes into, I guess, maybe preparing for them, or is it just kind of more general prep work? How does that work on your end?
Well, you know, we are, my staff, my assistant, Coach Dorsum, she does the with Scout. We use Synergy, and you know, we watch. She watches a lot of game clips and whatnot. And many times, I will do the pictures and watch the pictures. So we have some kind of game plan of, you know, what we're gonna see. But she calls the game. So you know, for her to be able to look at all the hitters and kind of see their weaknesses and whatnot, then it helps her with, you know, calling a game. But yeah, there's a lot of work that goes into it. She it's taken it takes a lot of her time. So, but you know, it's season and that's kind of her thing and she enjoys it. It's just a lot sometimes.
I don't actually. I was going to assume. I have no idea. I assume there's more prep work put into the series than like the one-off games, the or like the individual, like you know, like the Bellarmine game, for example, where it's just a singular game.
Oh yeah. Well, and two is that what makes it nice is before we would have two games against a certain, you know, university on a Saturday, two games on a Sunday. Well, then you're preparing for two games. So now, you know, two different teams, I mean, but so now it's, you know, you focus all week on one team. So, you know, you can spread it out a little bit. It's just a little bit easier to manage. And obviously the weekday games, you know, they matter, but they don't matter, you know, in a sense. Like you know, you got to put all your is most of your time into preparing for that conference game, and so we can, you know, ultimately, like, you know, get our goal, reach our goal at the end.
Is there a, I don't know if sense of pride is the right word. When you host some of these schools that are coming to, you know, here for the first time, I don't know if there's a goal, but is there any like kind of like, you know, sense of pride and like, you know, I guess what like Tennessee State's going to show up later this year? And is it like, you know, when they're seeing your facilities for the first time, is that like a
Yeah,
sense of
oh,
pride?
absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that our university has stepped it up, like when it comes to, you know, it's only year two and they're making some big changes at our field already. And our field was nice before, but they obviously know that for us to keep, you know, moving forward to an elite level, then that's what we have to do. And they are making some nice changes. A lot of renovation going up on up there actually as we speak. So it's of course, you know, and our facility is it hangs in there with the other ones that we went to last year, but obviously there was several that we were envious of in a sense, you know, just like, wow, that would be nice and we could really do that. And I bring my ideas back and I present them to the people here and they just see what they can do for us. But for year two, I'm pretty impressed.
I was going to say, just going to places help give you ideas for what you guys could do.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Especially when it came to like dugout ideas and you know, just kind of some renovations, some tweaks here and there. And you know, we're getting a new bullpen and hitting cage built at the field right now. And those were some different things that we had seen and how they set it up. So we're excited about it. It's going to be nice and just going to keep getting better year after year. I can only assume.
You know, we talked about a couple times here how your pitching's held up really good so far. So with the batters, is there anything like you, is there any, you know, I guess tricks or whatever to try to get batters, you know, I guess getting the hitting, you know, to where you want it? Or is it just kind of coming around because as the, you know, they're getting used to the faster pitching and stuff like that now?
Well, we do a lot of throwing live at practice, you know, because you know you can only do so many drills and whatnot. And we do focus on quite a bit of fundamental stuff, but we just really the more reps the better. I mean, it's you know, hitting is an art, and you know, there's you always are going to have weaknesses, but we teach them basically that they, I mean, you need to try to hide them, you know, and run with your strengths and utilize them. But we do a lot of live. We do as much as we can. So if the pitchers feel good and they're healthy, that's what we do.
Is that just the prefer you think that helps the most, almost more than anything? Is
I think so. Yeah, I think that, you know, I mean, it's just like anything, you know, you play like you practice, and you know, we we try to, you know, hone in on some of the things that are more realistic in a sense, but, you know, lots and lots of reps.
You have a lot of the, you know, most of the conference schedule remaining. What does that, you know, going into, we talked about there's more importance on those conference series than the weekday games. Is each kind of, and you guys, I guess, know this, you know, your scouting report going in on them. You know, what is there, how differently do you change your game plan based for a scouting report each game? Is there like, is it just kind of like, I guess, like, if you know a pitcher's tendencies, does it help you? Or does it kind of change how your hitters, I guess, play a little bit?
No, I think that more of it's they just get in a mindset of, you know, if we're going to see a rise ball pitcher, yeah, well, we can work on that throughout the week and, you know, or curveball. I mean, obviously changeups, you know, are difficult for every team. But if we know that that's the majority of what we're going to see, we focus on that throughout the week. But, you know, hitters, I mean, it's more about like having, like I said, your strength, and you have to go up to the plate with a plan. And, you know, you shouldn't steer away from your plan until you're forced to. So, you know, there's a lot that goes into it, but, you know, our kids are, they like to prepare as well. They watch film too. And, you know, just so they can kind of have in their mind what they're about to see.
You know, going into the season, I'm sure your goal is conference tournament every year, you know, or conference championship every year, you know, but I'm sure you have goals in this season, you know, what you're trying to hit, you know, because, you know, I guess progression. Do you think you're hitting most of those goals up to this point so far?
Not all of them. You know, to be, you know, quite frank, not all of them, but I do think that my biggest thing was, you have to see some kind of growth. And I'm really big on that. Like if we were making, you know, no mistakes at the beginning and now we're making a ton, like we're not kind of moving in the right direction. I do see some growth and that's a bonus. So I do feel like we check that box, like at least as long as we don't go backwards. But the other, you know, offensively, like yes and no. I think that there's some categories that we are hitting a little bit of a stride now. I think some others that we could do better. And, but yeah, I think pitching is starting to, you know, get a little bit more consistent and help us. And, you know, defensively, we definitely need to, you know, work on less errors and crucial errors. You know, it's the timely thing is what hurts us. You know, it's just like having runners in scoring position and not being able to have timely hits. We've left a lot of runners on base. So at the one plus is that we're getting them on, but the other one is that we need to score them. So, I mean, there's kind of a lot of it goes into it.
Is there even a way to try to practice that, or is that just kind of saying where it just has to happen?
I mean, we can hit live with runners on, you know, runners on and doing situational, but, you know, it's all about timely things, you know, and, you know, we obviously have done what we need to, but it's just a mindset, you know, it's just having the different mentality when you get to the plate. And, you know, some kids welcome it. Some kids, you know, don't really want that pressure. And that's a big thing. You know, you have to put them in pressure situations to be able to come through.
So how do you, I guess, yeah, it's like, you know, when you know that's maybe like an area of weakness, you know, and you practice it, is that something where do you look forward to those situations when you get them in games? Because you get to see if the practice is paying off.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, confidence is everything. And it, you know, if you can handle certain situations at practice and you keep grilling it with them and have success, then it's very welcoming. They're not so afraid to have the challenge in a game. So anytime you struggle with stuff like that, you attack it during the week, and hopefully they're in a good mindset and they're mentally confident, and then the weekend, it's all a go.
You know, you mentioned that there's a lot more recruiting time now, or a lot more time goes into recruiting now. Has that been the biggest change, or what has been the biggest change in the transition?
I think that, no, I don't think that's the biggest thing. I mean, I do think that we've added a lot to our plate. However, I do think that, a lot of it is behind the scenes stuff too. Like I'm busy and Coach Dorsum is busy with the two of us. It's only the two of us right now. And that has been a little trouble. Like there's just not enough hands, you know, even for practice, you know, we need more help. And, you know, just the behind the scenes, the paperwork, the software, the, you know, there's just a lot. So, I mean, I think that's been the biggest thing, to be honest.
Does that go down to scheduling too?
No, I mean, I do the schedule and we have, I have a theory, and then I still do it the way I did it back in when we were D2. You know, you can't play games that, you know, against teams that just are not competitive to be able to be good. And I get it that you have to still keep your kids confident and, you know, kind of bought in even when you suffer losses in preseason. But we always preach to them, like, those games are important. If you lose to an Alabama, you know, and you can hang, even if it's for five innings of it, you know, those are things that are positives going into playing, you know, the Eastern Illinois and the SEMOs and, you know, the teams that are just really solid. And I am a firm believer that you have to play the best to be the best. So that's what we do.
How enjoyable are those tournaments you have earlier in the season?
Oh, I mean, they're good. They're, you know, it does make for a lot of travel, and it makes for like being gone a long time, that whole month of, you know, mid-February to like mid-March, we are gone, and it wears on you. But I mean, you know, that's kind of part of the experience. You know, if we're gonna do this D1 thing and do it right, we need to give these kids that kind of experience, go to the cool places and, you know, see new stadiums and whatnot. I mean, our kids had a blast at Alabama. I mean, their facilities are beautiful. And you know, we went to Jacksonville State. Their facility is gorgeous. And it's, you know, there was good competition there. You know, we fared well, but it was a good time and very, really good thing to build some, you know, just kind of like get our kids to be a little more gritty. And they were. So it was good weekends, both of them. And Florida was actually a really good trip too. And we played well in Florida.
This is my final question. What have you enjoyed most about the transition from D2 to D1?
I guess the just the challenge of it. I push myself to be better. I'm by no means am I perfect in any way. I still am learning. I've been doing this, you know, 30 years, and I am still learning. And I think just the idea of some of the challenges ahead, I'm here for it. I want the challenge. I don't need things to be easy. I thrive on, you know, the growth and winning. I love to be successful. I just, you know, we got to keep the culture and the environment good. And I think that it'll be the rest of a good journey for me.
Well, I've been Hunter Wade with the Athlete Sonic podcast, and thanks for doing this, Coach.
Thank you for having me.
Hey guys, this is Hunter Wade with the Athletes Lounge podcast. Please like, share, and subscribe where you can. Thanks.